Welcome to Monday Night Bible Study, everyone. We're glad you're here. Give yourself a hand, would you? So glad you joined us by the internet. We get so many of your social messages, so thank you so much for being a part of what we're doing here at the Monday Night Bible Study. If you're new for the very first time tonight, I know Josh over here is new. If you're new, would you just stand up and let us give you a hand? First time to the Bible Study. Josh, we're glad you're here. So glad you're here. Welcome. Glad you're here. Thank you. Wow. So thank you. You could be watching the Astros win the pennant, but they're going to win, trust me. So, you know, we're going to jump right in. We're in 1 Corinthians 10. Lisa was supposed to speak tonight, and I think Eric announced that last week. She had something come up, so I stepped in here for her, so she'll be back in her normal rotation. I'm not sure when that'll be, but anyway, let's just open in a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to join our friends via the internet, Father. Just thank you for the opportunity to open your word, Lord. We thank you that your word is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, Father. We thank you that your word is as applicable and real today as it was the day that you wrote it, the day that you said it, Father. We just thank you, Father, for the opportunity just to sit at your feet as children. Lord, we just ask you to open your word to us, and we pray that our spiritual eyes would be open so that we could see what you'd have us to see. Our ears would be open to hear what you'd have us to hear. And Father, that our hearts would be receptive, and whatever you say to us, Jesus, we would quickly receive it and quickly obey it and quickly put it into practice in our life. Father, calm our mind and our heart from the busyness of the day and help us to settle in with our focus on you. Thank you that, Father, you said where two of us are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of us. Thank you that you're right here with us. You're right here in the homes of my friends that are watching. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Well, it's 1 Corinthians 10. It's a really great chapter in the Bible, and we're going to just read it all the way through, but we're going to do it in parts. I wanted to just kind of break it down into three parts, and I think I have a lot of this on the outline and also on the screens for you. Three parts to this chapter. The first is warnings from Israel's history and an encouragement. That's verses 1 through 13. And then the second part, I'll spend less time on this part because so much about the Lord's Supper is in the next chapter, but verses 14 to 22 are idol feasts and the Lord's Supper. And then the third part is what I call some things in our Christian life are black and white, but how do we handle the gray areas? Our freedoms as believers balanced against our responsibilities as believers. And I think that's a really good part of what we're going to talk about tonight. But let's just jump in here and read the first few verses. Again, this is the part for warnings from Israel's history. Okay, verse 1, chapter 10. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud. Now, by the ancestors, Paul is talking to a Greco-Roman audience, but many of those people are Jewish in heritage and in Jewish in faith. So when he talks about our brothers and sisters and our ancestors, brothers and sisters of the church there at Corinth, but ancestors specifically, he's talking about Jewish ancestry. And as we'll learn here in a minute, the people that were in part of the Exodus left the bondage in Egypt. Our ancestors that were under the cloud, everybody say cloud. And they all passed through the sea, say sea.
Sea.
They were baptized into Moses, again in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food, again say spiritual food.
Spiritual food.
They drank the same spiritual drink, again spiritual drink.
Spiritual drink.
For they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. That's a telling thought, sobering thought. God was not pleased with most of them, and their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now, just in context there, Paul is talking about his ancestry, the Jewish ancestry, and specifically he's talking about the children of Israel. Many of you know this, but I'm going to pretend you don't know this. They left bondage in Egypt. They were there for 400 years. You might remember that. They got there when Joseph and his brothers came for refuge. They grew into a great nation. They were there 400 years in bondage to the Egyptians, did a lot of their work, and they were very oppressed people. But God supernaturally delivered them. Amen. You might remember the 10 plagues, and the last plague being the Passover, where the death angel came through the all the area of Egypt and kill the firstborn unless, what? There was blood atop the doorposts of the houses. If the death angel came to where there was blood on the doorpost and the lintels and the sides of the house, he would pass over that house. That's where we get the word Passover. After that was a great deliverance. Moses helped them cross the Red Sea supernaturally. They were led through the wilderness, Sinai, across the Sinai Peninsula to Canaan, which the Promised Land is where they were going. It's an 11-day journey, and it took them a lot longer than 11 days to get there. But that's what Paul's talking about here. So he says the cloud. Look at Exodus 13, 21. I think it'll be up there for you somewhere. Exodus 13, maybe, maybe not. Is it working? Well, anyway, here's what it says. By day, the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way, and by night, a pillar of fire to give them light so that they could travel by day or night. Now, think about that. God was there in their presence, and He was a pillar of fire at night so that they could see if they needed to travel. He was a pillar of cloud during the day. And so they had direction and guidance. If the cloud moved or the pillar of fire moved, they moved. And they could see as they went, and they had clear direction. And that's what Paul's talking about. They were baptized into the cloud. But also he says they were baptized into the sea. Listen to this, Exodus 14. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters divided. Can you imagine this? The waters divided, and all the Israelites went through on a sea of dry ground, and a wall of water was on their left, and a wall of water was on their right. Can you imagine? Like they were in an aquarium walking right through the middle of it on dry ground. What a supernatural deliverance. But that's exactly what Paul's talking about here. And then he says they all ate the same spiritual food. Well, what food was that? Anybody remember? What's it called? Manna, yeah. Also some quail, but for the most part, it's manna. Then the Lord said to Moses, Exodus 16, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was like white coriander seed, and it tasted like wafers made with honey. So every day, supernatural provision, every day, Monday through Saturday. How many of you know they could gather enough on Saturday to rest on Sunday, and that they gathered on Saturday would last all the way through the weekend until Monday? So, you know, supernatural provision. Can you imagine 2-3 million people wandering through the desert and God supernaturally raining down vanilla wafers on the desert floor there? So, tastes like vanilla wafers, I'm sure. But anyway, then it said that they all had the same spiritual drink. Now, you might remember when they ran out of water and God said in Exodus 17 to Moses, strike the rock and water will come out of it for the people to drink. And again, we've already studied Jesus in the Old Testament. You know, that's a picture of Jesus in the Old Testament. Even the manna is a picture of Jesus in the Old Testament. But that's exactly what Paul's talking about. So, but in all of this, in verse 5 and then down in verse 11, it says, these things are examples and warnings to us. Now, what does Paul mean by that? I want you to think about this. The children of Israel were supernaturally delivered from their bondage in Egypt. They had seen incredible miracles, incredible provision. They were in a covenant relationship with God. They were His people, the children of Israel. They had God's presence, as I mentioned, to lead them and guide them and to be with them. And they had an incredible destiny in front of them, amen, called the Promised Land. They were to leave bondage and go to the Promised Land. But they didn't make it to the Promised Land, as I said. Only two people made it to the Promised Land. Who were they? Joshua and Caleb, the only two that made it to the Promised Land from all those people. And in this message, Paul, or in this passage, in this chapter, Paul mentions three things, three issues, three sins that kept the children of Israel out of the Promised Land. Now, let me just back it up to where we are in 2019. We too have been supernaturally delivered from bondage. Amen? We've been delivered supernaturally by the blood of Jesus from the bondage of our sin. Not by the blood of bulls and goats spread on the doorposts of a house, but on the cross of Jesus Christ and on the doorpost of our hearts. Amen. So we've been supernaturally delivered. We too are in a covenant relationship with God. He's our Father, isn't He? We're His children. We too have the Holy Spirit inside of us to lead us and guide us, don't we? And we too have an incredible destiny in front of us. Abundant life that God has for us right here, a destiny that He has for each and every one of us to fulfill. But also we have the hope of heaven. You know, we have the hope of that promised land when we die, we'll spend eternity with God in a place called heaven. So here's the point. Paul was warning the believers at Corinth then, back then, 2,000 years ago, as he's warning us today in 2019, learn from the examples of the children of Israel, and we need to take heed that we don't fall into the same issues, commit the same sins, and don't make it to our promised land just like so many of them didn't. Okay? So what are some of the things that kept him out of the promised land? Well, right there in verse 6, let's start reading. Now, these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were. Everybody say idolaters. Don't be idolaters as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality, say sexual immorality, as some of them did, and one day 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ as some of them did and were killed by snakes. And do not grumble. Everybody say, do not grumble. As some of them did, and they were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings to us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So one of the first things that Paul mentions here is that they were kept out of the promised land. One of the reasons was because of idolatry. Now let's just go back and rewind and study that particular scenario in the history of Israel. Do you remember that they came across the Red Sea and they came across into the wilderness? They were on their way to the promised land. And then Moses went somewhere for 40 days. Where did he go? Anybody know? He went up on the mountain. Which mountain was it? Anybody remember? Sinai. Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai represents the law because that's where God gave Moses the law up there. Remember, he wrote them on the tablets of stone with his own hands. But how many of you know that after he was gone for 40 days, the children of Israel got very impatient? Listen to this, and I think it's going to be on the screen for you. It's from Exodus 32. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come make us gods who will go before us." Can you imagine that? Come make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses, he's done all these great miracles who brought us out of Egypt. We don't even know what happened to him. Can you imagine that? Aaron answered them, sadly, this is Moses' brother, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." He took what they handed him and made them into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." Can you imagine what this must have done to God? "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, now listen, Aaron went and built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival in the land to the Lord." So the next day the people rose early, sacrificed burnt offerings, presented fellowship offerings. Afterwards they sat down to eat and drink, mentioned in this passage, and they got up to indulge in revelry. And most authors think revelry means drunken, immoral orgies. So in other words, they partied hard and they did anything they wanted to sexually. And all around the concept of saying, you know what, we can't see Moses anymore. You know, even though God's brought us out of these great things, you know what, we're just going to make something with our own hands and we're going to worship that. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? But I've often wondered, where did they get the idea of a calf? You know, I looked it up and I have a picture. I think they have that picture for you. This is one of the gods of Egypt, known as Hathor, H-A-T-H-O-R. And you think about it, perhaps these children of Israel watched the Egyptian gods and they said, well, listen, we're just going to make something like the Egyptians had. And that's the god called Hathor. And characteristically, it's a female goddess, actually. And she is usually in the form of a cow. But now listen, how do you and I, Andy, where's Andy? Andy, how do we conceptualize idolatry today in 2019? I mean, how do we do that in our culture today? Well, I think one of the ways that we can begin to even think about it is to define what an idol is. And I have that for you. An idol is an object of extreme devotion. Think about that. Now, just simplistically think about that. An object of extreme worship. Could be a thing, could be an object, could be a person. You know, think about that. Others say that an idol, as far as a Christian's concerned, anything that becomes more important than God in our lives. How many of you know God wants our extreme devotion? He wants our full devotion. He doesn't want partial devotion. Anything that disproportionately consumes our thoughts, our actions, and our resources. Think about that. Or then I like this other definition. Anything that takes God's place in giving us fulfillment, satisfaction, security, or significance. So I think it's a sobering thing to think, what can become an idol in my life? What could become an object of extreme devotion for me? What can compete with our devotion to God? I've listed several things that I think that we could think about, but you know, it may be different for you. I think work can do it. Success can do it. Money can do it. Living up to an image can do it. You know, things can do it. I have so many friends, you know, back in where I used to practice, they have so many things and they're so unhappy. You know why? Because their devotion's not in the right place. They're devoted to things and not to God. Children, I think children can become an idol. Sports can become an idol. All you guys say amen, okay? Social media can become an idol. You know, recreation, pleasure can become an idol. I just think it's good if we're going to really study this passage, let's think, you know, what could become an idol in my life? I went and began to think about some of the passages where Jesus mentioned, or some of the writers of the New Testament mentioned things that could perhaps get us off track and could be thought of as an idol. I love what Jesus said in the parable of the sower. I want you to think about the parable of the sower. So a farmer went out and he threw out seed. Some of it fell on the rock. You get that. Some of it fell on the path and the birds got that. That's easy to understand. Some of it fell on the rock where there's a rock underneath and it didn't have any root. But the one that really gets me is the one that fell in the weeds. That was good soil. There wasn't anything wrong with that soil. It didn't have any rocks in it. It had good nutrients. It just had something competing with the seed. That's something that's like an idol, isn't it? Jesus said this, the seed that fell among the thorns stand for those who hear the word, but they, as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures. Just think about that. You know, those are the things Jesus mentioned. Be careful. And then I love what John says in 1 John. He says, do not love the world or anything in the world. If you love the world, love for the Father's not in you. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful people. Now just put yourself in there. The cravings of Paul Osteen, the lust of my eyes, the boasting of what I have or what I do comes not from the Father, but from the world. See, the fact is we can't boast about what we have. We can't always want what our eyes see. We can't, you know, be indulgent in just sensual pleasures. And another sobering thought from Jesus, and actually this has really been on my heart the last couple of months. Revelations 2:4, he says this, yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. You were devoted to me at once. You know what, but maybe some idols have come in now and you've forsaken, that's a terrible word, you've forsaken your first love. And then Jesus in Matthew 24, in the last days, how many of you know we're living in the last days? The last days started when Jesus went back to heaven and they'll end when he comes back to this earth. But we're living in the last of the last days. And listen to what Jesus said, because of the increase of wickedness in the last days, the love of most will grow cold. Whoever stands firm to the end will be saved. But that's very sobering to me to think of 100 Christians in the room, the love of most will grow cold. So I think it stirs me up to say, Paul, be devoted to Jesus all the way to the end. You know what? Don't let anything distract you. And Paul says in Timothy almost the same thing. There will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves. How many of you know you can be an idol? You can love yourself. Lovers of money, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. So, you know, I think it's important if we're going to honestly approach this passage, to examine our own lives and say, is there anything in my life that's taking the place of God as far as devotion is concerned? And secondly, Is my love growing cold for Jesus? Is my devotion and my passion growing cold? Not to be negative at all, not to, you know, condemn or anything, just sobering to think about those things. Because you know what? How many of you want to reach your promised land? I do not want idolatry to keep me from being everything that God wanted me to be. Amen? The second thing, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, is sexual immorality. We've talked a lot about this. This was a very pagan culture. But Paul refers back and he says, listen, sexual immorality kept them from the promised land. Numbers 25, while Israel was staying in Shittim, the men began to indulge in sexual immorality with the Moabite women who invited them to sacrifice to their gods. Can you imagine that? The people ate the sacrificial meal and bowed down before these gods. So Israel yoked themselves. Remember when I talked, when you have sexual connection with people, there's a yoke, there's a bond that happens. They yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor, and the Lord's anger burned against them and those who died in the plague. When God's wrath was poured out on them, 24,000 people died in that particular judgment on those people. Bottom line is this: sexual immorality can keep us from our promised land. It can keep us from our destiny. It can keep us from God's best for our lives. And then the third thing he mentions here is grumbling and complaining. Anybody grumbled and complained today? I think I have been guilty of that. But you know what? This makes you stop and say, wait a minute. Every time grumbling and complaining comes out of my mouth, it comes from the passage in Numbers 21. It says, the people grew impatient on the way, Israelites. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There's no bread, there's no water, and we detest this miserable food, manna. The Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people and many died. And it's mentioned in this passage. And all of the Israelites in Numbers 14 grumbled. All of the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron. And the whole assembly said to them, if we had only died in Egypt or in this wilderness, why is the Lord bringing us to a land to let us die by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? Isn't that telling? Wouldn't it be better to pack it all up, cross the Red Sea, and go back to all that bondage in Egypt? God was so disappointed at their grumbling and complaining. In Numbers 14, he says, in the wilderness, your bodies will fall. Every one of you 20 years old or more who's grumbled against me will die in the wilderness. I looked it up. They say up to 2 million people died in the wilderness. Think about that. All the 2 or 3 million that started out, you know, they didn't make it to their promised land. Only the little ones made it, but all the adults didn't. Now, we live under grace and not the law, but you have to realize these things occurred and they were written down as examples to us to keep our hearts from being set on evil, and as examples and as warnings to us. I think there's going to be a picture of a warning sign up there. I think it's coming up soon. But you know when you see a warning sign when you're driving, how many of you know you take caution? That's all Paul's saying here. Listen, I'm going to tell you three areas you need to be careful with. You know what? Be careful in these three areas: idolatry, grumbling and complaining, and sexual immorality. Now, at the end, though, there's an encouragement, and I want you to read this. These things happen, verse 11, these things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. So there's no room for pride here. Don't think you're so in such a good situation that you're standing so firm that you couldn't fall. No temptation. Here's the encouragement. No temptation has overtaken you, but except that is common to all of us. And God is faithful. Everybody say that. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted. Say it. Beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will provide a way out so that you can endure it. Isn't that a great thought? You know, every time we're tempted in sexual immorality, or tempted in idolatry, or tempted in any area, tempted in grumbling and complaining, no matter what the situation, no matter what test or what temptation we're in, God will give us the strength. He won't allow us to go in through something that's too difficult for us. And that's comforting, isn't it? Number two, He'll give us strength. And number three, He'll always give us a way out. Think about that. He'll always give us a way out. So I want you to think about that concept just for a second. Every temptation that I face, every temptation that you face, God will give me a way out. If I'll just listen and have an obedient heart, you know, resist my flesh and follow my spirit. Moses, in Hebrews 11, the Bible talked about how Moses resisted the temptations there with Potiphar's wife, and says he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God, listen to this, rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. So I just want to compare and contrast those two things for you. We either have a way out that God's provided, or we can have some fleeting pleasure of sin. But that fleeting pleasure will not let us live the kind of life that God wants us to live. So my encouragement to you today is just look for the way out. There's always a way out for you and for me that God's provided for you. Let me just read that. I think I have it in the Message Bible. It's just so poignant in the Message Bible. I think it'll be on the screen for you. These are the warning markers, danger in our history books, written down so that we don't repeat their mistakes. Our positions in the story are parallel. They are at the beginning, we are at the end, and we are just as capable of messing it up as they were. So don't be naive and self-confident. You're not exempt. You could fall flat on your face as easily as anyone else. Forget about self-confidence. It's useless. Cultivate God confidence. Isn't that good? No test or temptation that comes your way is beyond the course of what others have had to face. All you need to remember is that God will never let you down. He'll never let you be pushed beyond your limit. He'll always be there to help you come through it. Amen? Isn't that good? So here's the questions I have for you. Number one, has anything or anyone become an idol in my life? Am I involved in sexual immorality in any way? And you know there's lots of ways to be involved in that. Do I grumble and complain on a regular basis? In times of testing, am I looking for the way of escape that God has provided, or am I looking for the fleeting pleasures of sin, or am I ignoring what God's provided? Those are the questions I think we can answer from the first passage. But what about the second part of the passage there? Paul says, therefore, my friends, verse 14, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ, and not the bread we break, a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, we all partake of that loaf. Now clearly he's talking about the Lord's Supper there. The body of the Lord Jesus Christ broken is for us. The blood that is shed that we take as the grape juice is his blood shed for our forgiveness. He notes there too that we are the body of Christ. You know, he makes reference there. So not only is this the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, but he refers to us as the body of Christ. But here's the dilemma. Now, back in that culture, they would have these pagan culture around them. It was very common to have a meal or a feast to celebrate or to worship a pagan god. And very often what would happen, they'd have this big worship celebration. They would do all this sacrifice, make all these sacrifices, and then everybody would sit down for a meal. Let me give you an example of that. I've got a quote that I found that's from way, way back. And here it's called Clarimon. I don't know how you say his name. Cherimon, this is a person, invites you to a meal at the table of Lord Serapis. That's a god in the temple or the Serapeum tomorrow, the 15th, from 9 o'clock onwards. See, so he's inviting people, come to this place, and we're going to celebrate this particular god, and then we're going to have a big feast together. Well, here's the problem. Some of the believers in Corinth were eating at these meals and then coming over and eating the Lord's Supper as well. And Paul's saying in verse 16, consider the people of Israel. Don't those who eat the sacrifice participate in the altar? Do I mean then that food sacrificed to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink of the cup of the Lord, and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. Are we trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy? Are we stronger than He is? Well, I think it's real obvious this Paul's saying, listen, you can't double dip here. Here's what I think it means to us today. You know what? You can't have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom. You got to make a decision. You know what? It's not going to work like that. You can't eat with the demons and worship the demons and also have a foot in the kingdom. You got to make a decision. And I think that's the challenge to us. In any way, the second part, in any way, am I trying to keep one foot in my old way of life and one foot in my new way of life? That's compromise, and God doesn't bless compromise. What He wants you to do is to be fully all in for Jesus. Amen? Well, listen, the third part of the passage, and this is a real, real good part, I think, is, you know, there are some things in the Bible that are just clear. We know that they're right or they're wrong. They're black or they're white. There's no doubt about it. But how many of you know some of the things that we face are gray? They're not mentioned in the Bible. You know, what you can post on a social media post, it's not in the Bible, is it? Is abortion in the Bible? It's not mentioned. Is some of these things that, you know, that we all deal with daily, what's modest dress? What's, you know, all these things are they're gray. And so Paul is talking about a situation here where the meat that was sacrificed to idols was then taken to the market. And there was this dilemma: can we buy meat in the market, even though it's kind of been stamped, it's been to the idols, or should we not? Or what if somebody sees us eating it? And Paul addresses that so beautifully here. Look in verse 23. I have the right to do anything, you say. Not everything is beneficial, though. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. No one should seek their own good. Very, very important scripture, but the good of others. Eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. So if you see meat in the market, don't ask. Just buy it and eat it and enjoy it. God provided it. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if someone says to you, what's been offered to you has been offered in sacrifice. Let me start that over. But if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then don't eat it for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. And I'm not referring to your conscience, but for the other person's conscience. So what he's saying here is this. If you're in a meal and somebody says to you, this was offered to to an idol, then you probably should not eat that. And Paul's saying, for the reason that you don't want to ruin your witness to that person there. Their conscience may be convicted by it. You don't want to do something that's going to lead them astray. So he's saying, you know, don't do that. Instead, he goes on to say, if I take part in a meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews or Greeks or the church of God, even as I try to please everyone in every way, for I'm not seeking my own good, but for the good of many, so that many may be saved. Now, let me just boil that down to you as we come to an end. There's so many things in life that you know, which way do we go? Some Christians say we can do this, some say we can do that. The Bible's not clear on this. And I would just encourage you to think about this passage that is from a friend of mine's book he wrote. It's called The Bible from 30,000 Feet. Our world and culture today, I think it's going to be up there for you. Our world and culture today are loaded with gray areas, things the Bible doesn't specifically address or that grace has fulfilled in regard to the law's requirements so that we don't have to obey them anymore. For instance, we don't have to sacrifice animals. We don't have to, you know, do that anymore. But as you consider how you let the culture into your life, books, movies, music, websites, fashion, smoking, drinking, social media, and on, first consider God's overreaching commandment to love God with all your heart and to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus told us to love each other in the church especially well, since it creates a strong witness to the outside world. Biblical principles should provide the basis of our behavior, but in areas of non-essential doctrine, let love guide you through the gray areas. Whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. I love that. So here's, that's good, isn't it? So here's a few questions that I have for you. And I think it's good for all of us just think about this. And I wrote them down there, and I think these are good thoughts to consider in gray areas. Number one is, whatever I'm going to do, sin. you see the blank there, is, you know, going to an R-rated movie, sin. Okay? Does the Bible say, you know, you got to weigh that? Is it sin? Now, if it's sin, you need to back away from that. Number two, does it negatively affect my fellow believers, especially those who are new to the faith? Okay? Does it negatively affect them? In other words, if I do something that my conscience doesn't convict me on, but it leads somebody else astray, goodness, I need to be careful about that. Number three, does whatever I'm about to do affect my testimony to non-believers? So if I go to a certain club and everybody else is at the club and they're doing things they shouldn't be doing, how does that make me look as far as non-believers? At least you need to consider that. Number four, does it go against my conscience? I think that's a very important thing. You know what? The Holy Spirit's down inside of us, and He leads us by our conscience often. How many of you have been starting to do something and you felt something on the inside go, don't do that? Anybody ever felt that? Anybody ever ignored it and gotten in trouble? But listen, the key point is my dad used to say the simplest thing about the Christian faith is just listen to your own conscience, because that's where Jesus and the Holy Spirit live, and just following that and being sensitive to it. And I think that's a very important thing. And don't get into so much to sin so consistently that Bible says that your conscience can be seared. You know what seared means? It's just burned, and so it doesn't feel anything anymore. So keep your conscience very sensitive. But number four, does it go against my conscience? Number five, have I asked mature believers about whatever I'm about to do? I think that's really important. You know, if I'm about to, I met a guy and I know him for 6 hours and we're going to get married. Well, let's think about that for a second. Have you asked a mature believer about that? So, I mean, there's some things that you need just somebody to get some common sense in you and say, oh, you know what? I've lived a little bit of life and I can tell you it probably would be good to wait for 2 or 3 years, honestly. But anyway, consult mature believers. I mean, somebody that you know follows Jesus closely. And number five is this, or number six is this, is it unwise? That's a real simple question, but would it be unwise for me to buy a brand new $70,000 car when I'm $60,000 in credit card debt? I mean, is it wise? You know, the Bible doesn't say you can't do that. But here's the point. Is it wise? So I think those six things are really good ways to just kind of evaluate things. And because our freedom as followers of Jesus is always tempered by our love and our consideration of other people. Now, let me talk to you about the flip side of that that's equally bad or equally a challenge or a danger. There's a danger, though, in making our spiritual preferences, what we do in the gray areas, spiritual principles or laws that other people have to follow. And if they don't follow them, we'll judge them. You know what I'm talking about? In other words, it's a gray area. This is what I've decided to do, but I'm going to judge you if you don't do what I do. You know what? That's equally wrong. You know what? Because it's a gray area. How many of you know that church has been divided over that? Families have been divided over that? Christian fellowship has been divided over that? You know what? The gray areas we need to say, hey, they're gray. And you know what? I'm not going to judge you if your conscience is something different than mine. Amen? So another question is, am I making what I do in the gray areas a spiritual principle that other people must follow? I think that's a good question to ask yourself. As we wrap it up, chapter 10, here's Paul's encouragement to each and every one of us, including me. Don't let idolatry, sexual sin, or grumbling keep us from our promised land, our destiny that God has for each and every one of us. Number two, don't have one foot in the world and one foot in the church. You know what? God wants our wholehearted, complete devotion. Number three, in the gray areas, follow your conscience, be sensitive to others, especially not to cause anyone to stumble by what you do. And the last thing is this. Everything we do, how many of you know, we need to do it for God's glory. Amen. Did you receive that? Did it bless you? Amen. Eric's going to come up here and he's going to dismiss us in prayer. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Paul. Give Dr. Paul a hand clap again. That was fantastic. Learned so much. But hey, make sure that you come out next week to Monday Night Bible Study. But like we say every week, not just Monday Night Bible Study, make sure you're coming out to everything here at Lakewood, the midweek service, the weekend services. There is so much for every one of us. Amen? All right, let's close out in prayer. Father, we just thank you so much. We thank you so much for your word tonight. We thank you, Lord, that we heard it. It's in our heart. It's renewing our minds. Lord, show us those areas in our lives where maybe we have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom. I thank you, Lord, that you will gently correct us, you'll comfort us, lead us, and guide us. We just hear you speaking to us personally. And we thank you, Lord, that you are so good to us, so faithful to us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, see you next week.